Hi everyone, my name is Philippe Balbiani. I am working in the research group about logic, interaction, language and computation in the Toulouse Institute of Computer Science Research in France. And I will give some introductory information about the problem of unification or the problem of solving equations in modal and description logic. I think we are not such a large number of participants. So if at some moment you have questions, of course you can use the chat box, and I will try to answer you. So the problem of unification in computer science and automatic deduction, it is quite a classical problem, and its informal definition can be given as follows. It is the problem given two terms to make them identical by replacing some of their variables by terms. Of course, identical here, it can mean different things, but mainly identical modulo some equational theory. And the first references on this question are given below, for example, the paper of Knut and Bendix and the paper of Robinson about the resolution principle, which are classical papers. If you're interested in the theory of unification in equational theories, you may also consider to read these articles by Franz Baader, Wen Snyder, and Jorge Sigmund. So the formal definition of unification, and we will see later how to introduce unification in propositional logic and description logic. The formal definition of unification is to consider first some signature, sigma, that is to say some function symbol together with their arities, some constant symbol and variables, and to define terms, in fact, first order terms, as it is classically done. A term S or T is either a variable or a constant or a function applied to some other term according to the arity of the function.
Philippe, sorry to interrupt you.
Oui, yes.
We still see the first slide. I'm not moving.
What is the first slide? Let me see. You mean the introductory slides, the title slides?
Okay, the title. Now we see introduction with the formal definition.
Okay.
Thank you.
And if I move to the next slides, do you see the next slide starting by example?
No, not yet.
Okay. It is a little bit disturbing. Okay. And now, do you see the slide starting by example?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, so in this setting, first order language based on some signature sigma, we define substitutions as usual. It is a substitution is a function with a finite domain, consisting to replace some variables x1 to xn by some terms from the language, terms s1 to sn. So a substitution is like a function which replaces variable by terms with finite domain. And the unification problem in this setting is to determine, given two terms s and t, if we can substitute the variable of these terms by some other terms in such a way that the resulting terms are equal. So it is the classical problem. And for example, if we are given these two terms, f of x, g of ab, and f of g, yb, and x, I hope you can see them on the slides. A solution or a unifier of these two terms consists to replace the variable x by g of ab and to replace the variable y by a. And this substitution or this unifier will be denoted as it is written in the slides. Okay. Excuse me, do you see now the slides introducing commutative function?
Yes, yes, it's okay.
It's okay. But when the function f is supposed to be a commutative, that is to say, when we do reasoning in the theory, equational theory of a commutative function f, then the previous substitution is still a unifier of the two terms, but there is also another unifier which is more simple, which consists just by replacing the variable y by the constant a. And in a way, this new unifier is more general than the previous one. Now, if we assume that the function f is associative, that is to say, it should satisfy the associativity conditions, then we are in a not so good situation, because still the first substitution sigma is a unifier, but now there is infinitely many substitutions which are written here, which are also unifier of the two terms. And in a way, this infinite sequence of unifier is essentially a minimal complete set of unifier of the two terms. So here we have seen some informally some concept. What is a unifier? What is a unification problem? What is a unifier? And what does it mean to be a most general unifier or a minimal complete set of unifier? And we will develop this concept within the context of propositional logic. So let us consider a propositional logic. Let us consider a propositional logic. By propositional logic, I mean a classical logic or intuitionistic logic or any other intermediate logic. We can also consider the standard modal logic S4, S5, and also the description logic, for example, FL0 or EL. Of course, the syntax and the semantic of this propositional logic will be different, but we will introduce them when it is needed later. What is a unification problem in this setting? Consider a propositional logic L. A unification problem, we can introduce it in some different ways. We can consider a pair of formulas and to ask the question if there is a substitution sigma such that applying the substitution to the two given formulas make them equivalent in the logic. Or we can consider that a unification problem is given by a finite set of pairs of formulas. And the problem now is to determine if there exists a substitution sigma, replacing the variable of the formulas by some new formulas, in such a way that for each pair, applying the substitution sigma to the two formulas of the pair make these two formulas equivalent in L. In some case, the unification problem in a propositional logic is simply given a given formula phi, and the question is to find a substitution sigma which make when we apply it to the formula, it makes it a member of the logic. For example, consider, so the general definition of elementary unification in a propositional logic L is given some formula psi, I have written here its propositional variable, x1 to xn. The question is to determine if we can substitute the variable x1 to xn by other formula of the language in such a way that the resulting formula is a member of the logic. Here, this problem is called elementary unification because we accept to replace any propositional, any atomic formula of the given formula psi by some new formula. For example, an example of a unification problem in this setting, for example, in classical logic, will be this equivalence. And it has a lot of unifiers. For example, a solution to this unification problem is to replace x, the three variable, by false. Or there is some other solution here. It can, in this example, we see that a unification problem can have many solutions. You can see that if you replace the three variable of this formula by false, the resulting equivalence is valid classically. But there is a solution which is written in the last line, and this solution is, we can prove it is the most general solution of this unification problem. We will see precisely what it means to be the most general unifier of the of this given formula. It means simply that any other unifier of the given formula can be obtained as an instance of this substitution. There is a more general unification problem in propositional logic. It is called unification with parameters. In this case, the given formula is a propositional formula of some propositional language based on some set of propositional variables, but it also contains a propositional constant denoted by this letter P1 to Pm. And it is possible in this setting to replace only the propositional variable by new formula, and the question is therefore to determine if it exists formula phi1 to phi n such that when we replace in psi the propositional variable by phi1 and phi n, we obtain a resulting formula which is a member of the logic. For example, in this case, what is a unification problem? In the case of unification with parameter, it can be this formula, x and p, equivalent to y and q. Here, the variable are x and y. These are the variables that we will try to replace by formula. And the parameters are the propositional constant p and q. And as it is, this formula is not unifiable because if it were unifiable, it means that it would be possible to replace x and y by some propositional formula in such a way that the resulting formula is valid or is a member of the given propositional logic L. But this would imply in particular that the parameter Q implies the parameter P. And since I have assumed that P and Q are different symbols, then this is impossible and the formula is not unifiable. Okay. Why to consider the unification problem in propositional logic? There is a traditional question in any propositional logic. It is the so-called admissibility problem. This problem concerns inference rule. The admissibility problem is the following. Suppose we are in some propositional logic L, for example, classical logic, modal logic S4, etc. Suppose we are given a rule of inference. It has the hypothesis phi1 to phi m and a conclusion psi. This rule is admissible. What does it mean? It means that for all formula chi1 to chi n, if we replace in this in a uniform way, if we replace in the rule the n variable by the formula chi1 to chi n, and if the resulting formula corresponding to the hypothesis of the rule are in the logic, then the resulting formula corresponding to the conclusion of the rule is also in the logic. It is quite easy to prove that this rule of inference is admissible in classical logic. As well, it is admissible in intuitionistic propositional logic. This rule of inference, if we consider the modal propositional language with the additional symbol of box for necessity, this rule of inference is admissible in modal logic K, the simplest normal modal logic. This last rule of inference is also admissible in the Gödel-Löb modal logic. So for example, this rule of inference is admissible in intuitionistic logic. It means that if we replace in a uniform way the variable of this rule by some formula, then the resulting hypothesis of the rule, if it is a member of the intuitionistic logic, then the corresponding instance of the conclusion of the rule will also be a member of the logic. Why I am talking about admissibility in the context of the unification problem in propositional logic? Because it is possible to relate in a very precise way the admissibility problem and the unifiability problem. Consider that L is a consistent propositional logic. For example, intuitionistic logic, modal logic S5. It is easy to show that the following conditions are equivalent. The formula phi is unifiable if and only if the rule of inference, which is this rule of inference, in a way it is a kind of passive rule of inference because we never want to apply it really. So the given formula phi is unifiable if and only if this rule of inference is non-admissible. It means that if we can solve the admissibility problem in the logic L, then we can solve the unifiability problem in the logic L. It has been noticed that we can also reduce the admissibility problem to the unifiability problem in the case when the logic L is finitary or unitary. We will see precisely what it means for a logic to be finitary or unitary, but roughly it means that if a formula phi is unifiable in this logic, then it possesses a finite minimal complete set of unifiers. It possesses a finite set of maximal unifiers. And then in this context, a rule of inference is admissible if and only if when we consider the finite set of maximal unifiers of this conjunction, since we have assumed that the logic is finitary or unitary, this finite set of maximal unifiers exists. And for each maximal unifier of this conjunction, this is the maximal unifier, the formula corresponding to the conclusion of the rule when we apply this unifier is in the logic. So this means that in such finitary or unitary logic, if we can solve the unifiability problem, then we can solve the admissibility problem. Another interest to consider the unification problem is coming from the description languages. This is a question that has been put forward mainly by Franz Baader. In description logic, we can roughly consider that description languages consist are fragment, syntactic fragment of the modal languages. Of course, if we go into detail, things are more complex. So given two concept definitions in some description language, for example, FL0 or EL, we want to solve this unification problem. And the motivation to consider such problem is that maybe the concept definition C and D, they are not subsuming each other, but we, in some way, they can be made equivalent by replacing their variables by some other concept definition. In this setting, for example, in the setting of description logic FL0, we can consider these two concept definition. Here we have the variable X and the variable Y. We have the role symbol R and the role symbol S. And we have the concept constant A. This is conjunction, and this is the box modality, the necessity modality corresponding to the role R, and the necessity modality corresponding to the role S. The unification problem, given this two concept definition, has a solution. For example, it consists to replace the concept variable X by this concept definition, and to replace the concept variable Y by this concept definition. Here you see that it is not so easy to determine existence of a unifier of the concept definition C and D. And we will see later in the context of description language FL0, how this can be automatically done. There is a recent and motivation to illustrate the interest to consider the unification problem. It is in the context of epistemic planning. In epistemic planning, we are considering some language of dynamic epistemic logic, for example, public announcement logic. And we are given two formula, phi and psi, epistemic formula describing some initial situation for phi and final situation, final expected situation for psi. So phi and psi are epistemic formula in a multi-agent epistemic language. And for example, we want to solve this formula. What does it mean to solve this formula? Here, X is a propositional variable. It is the unknown variable of the problem. Ki is the epistemic operator of knowledge for agent I. And this formula, to solve it, means to find which formula could replace X in such a way that the resulting implication is valid in public announcement logic. For example, if the formula phi describing the initial situation is this one, it means agent one knows P and agent two knows that P implies Q. The final situation, final expected situation is this formula saying that agent two knows Q. And then to solve this unification problem, we see that if agent one publicly announces that she knows P, then after the announcement by agent one that P holds, it will be agent two will know that Q holds. Then it is possible to determine variant of this epistemic planning problem and to try to solve it by means of technique related to the unification problem. And there is a last motivation to consider the unification problem in propositional logic, and it comes from some quite old paper of Büttner and Simonis, in which Boolean expressions were embedded in logic programming. Büttner and Simonis have considered some variant of logic programming in which the terms which are given as argument to the predicate of the logic programming language are not first order terms, but Boolean terms, Boolean expressions. For example, here, I have given the example taken from their paper of two horn clauses based on the predicate symbol adder and half adder. And you can see that the argument of this predicate symbol in the two clauses, they are not first order terms, but Boolean expressions. For example, here we have the conjunction of the two variables x and y, and here we have the disjunction of the two variables u and v. And this gives a motivation. So since we know that the main inference step in the logic programming setting is based on the resolution principle and the unification algorithm between terms, we understand that if we want to apply one resolution step in the setting of such horn clauses, it is needed to determine how we can solve the unification problem between Boolean terms. So some last remark before going into more details about the unification problem. If we consider classical logic or intuitionistic logic, the elementary unification problem is equivalent to the consistency problem, or if you prefer, the satisfiability problem, if the logic can be semantically defined. Remember that the elementary unifiability problem is given a formula which consists only of propositional variables. It does not contain parameters or propositional constants. The elementary unifiability of such formula is to try to find a substitution such that when we apply to the given formula, the resulting formula is a member of the logic. So in the case of classical propositional logic, for example, this problem is equivalent to the consistency problem because if a formula has a unifier, then it has a ground unifier. A ground unifier is a substitution sigma which does not introduce any variable. It replaces the variable of the given formula to be unified by variable-free formulas. And in classical logic or in intuitionistic logic, every variable-free formula is either equivalent to false or to true. And therefore, by means of the inference rule of uniform substitution, elementary unifiability can be reduced to consistency, and therefore, it is an NP-complete problem for this logic. In modal logic like S4 or S5, elementary unifiability is not equivalent to consistency. This is the first difference, because, for example, consider this formula. It is a conjunction, diamond X and diamond not X. This conjunction, in this conjunction, the diamond is the dual of the box operator. This conjunction is satisfiable, for example, in modal logic S4. But it is not possible to find a substitution sigma such that when we apply the substitution sigma to this conjunction, the resulting formula is a member of S4. Because if it is, then we will obtain a contradiction. The formula false would belong to the modal logic S4, which is not possible. So no formula of that kind, although they are satisfiable, they are consistent, they are not unifiable. Let us see some example in modal logic S4. This formula, this disjunction, box not X or box X, where box is the additional connective of necessity in the modal logic, It is unifiable. You can easily recognize that if you apply to this formula the substitution consisting to replace x by true or x by false, then the resulting formula, the resulting disjunction, is a member of S4. It can be proved, and it is not difficult, that these two substitutions are essentially the only solution of this unification problem. And this can be proved by using the modal disjunction property of S4. If a formula of the form box phi or box psi is in S4, then either phi or psi is in S4. And in a way, it means that sigma true and sigma false, defined here, constitute a minimal complete set of unifiers for this unification problem in S4. Now, in the minimal modal logic K, consider this formula, X implies box X, it is unifiable. For example, if you consider the substitution sigma true, you obviously apply it, if you apply it to the given formula, it becomes a member of K. But there is more complex unifiers of the given formula X implies box X, which is this family of unifiers, sigma K, consisting to replace X by this formula. And it can be proved that essentially, this infinite set of unifiers of the given formula is a complete set of unifiers. Unfortunately, it is not minimal, because if we eliminate from this infinite set of unifiers one of this sigma k, we still obtain a complete set of unifiers. And it means that this formula is unifiable in K, but it does not possess a minimal complete set of unifiers. In modal logic S5, if we consider the first formula, box not X or box X, it is of course unifiable again in S5, because S5 contains S4, but it has only essentially one most general unifier, which consists to replace X by box X. We will see later how we can compute the most general unifier of a given formula in modal logic S5. We have seen that the formula X implies box X in K has infinitely many, has no minimal complete set of unifiers. It happens that in S5, the same formula possesses a most general unifier, this one. Now, the last words I want to say in this introductory part is about admissibility problem and the derivability problem of inference rule. Suppose that L is a propositional logic, and there is the standard definition of derivability of a rule. Consider this inference rule. By definition, it is derivable in the logic if there exists a derivation in the logic of the conclusion of the rule from the hypothesis of the rule. It is, when I say derivation, I mean the standard definition of a derivation. As we know, the admissibility of the rule means that for all substitution sigma, when we apply sigma to the hypothesis of the rule, if the resulting formula are in the logic, then the resulting formula corresponding to the conclusion of the rule is also in the logic. It is easy to show that every derivable rule is admissible, but it can happen that the converse does not hold. And we say that the logic L is structurally complete if every admissible rule is derivable. If we only consider classical propositional logic, It is known, it is a standard result, that it is structurally complete. Every admissible rule is derivable, and therefore, admissibility in classical logic is decidable. In fact, the admissibility problem in classical logic is equivalent to the derivability problem or to the validity problem. But if we consider other propositional logic, for example, intuitionistic propositional logic, there exists admissible rule, and it was known since many years. There exists admissible rule in intuitionistic propositional logic, which are not derivable. For example, these inference rule, they are admissible in intuitionistic logic, but they are not derivable. It was known since many years. And it happens that knowing the relationship between intuitionistic logic and modal logic S4, we can also prove by this relationship being considered by means of the so-called Gödel translation of intuitionistic formula into modal formula. It was known also that in modal logic S4, this inference rule, which is called the modal Lehmann-Scott rule, is admissible but not derivable. If you know what is the Gödel translation of intuitionistic formula into the language of modal logic S4, you will recognize that this inference rule is nothing but the Gödel translation of the Lehmann-Scott rule. In fact, it was remarked by Vladimir Rybakov that if L is some intermediate logic, that is to say, propositional logic between intuitionistic logic and classical logic, such intermediate logic has modal companions. For example, intuitionistic logic corresponds to modal logic S4. It corresponds also to modal logic S4 extended by the Tregongic axiom. Well, Rybakov has noticed that if some rule of inference R is admissible in an intermediate logic L, then the modal translation of the rule, modal translation, I mean Gödel translation of the rule, is admissible in the greatest companion of modal companion of this intermediate logic. So in a way, we can see that the admissibility problem in intermediate logic and the admissibility problem in modal logic above S4 are strongly related. So the historical result in the setting of unification and admissibility have been obtained by Vladimir Rybakov first. He's an important figure in the topic of admissibility and unification. And he has remarked first that the admissibility problem in modal logic S4.3 and its extension is decidable. S4.3 is the modal logic interpreted over a relational structure with transitive and linear accessibility relations. Later, he has proved the very important result, saying that the admissibility problem in transitive modal logic like K4, S4, Gödel-Löb logic is decidable. The admissibility problem and therefore the unification problem with or without parameters. The decidability problem obtained by Rybakov with respect to the admissibility problem and the unification problem are concerning only decidable intermediate logic or decidable modal logic, S4, S4.3. So the question was to determine if it exists a decidable logic for which the admissibility problem is undecidable, and it has been obtained by Alexander Shagroff, who has defined a decidable normal modal logic with an undecidable admissibility problem. Unfortunately, the normal modal logic defined by Shagroff is rather artificial, and so the question was still to determine the existence of more natural modal logic decidable modal logic for which the unification problem is undecidable. It has been done by Voltaire and Zakariachev, who have proved that every modal logic between K and K4, when the language is extended by the universal modality, and these modal logic are decidable, their complexity is well known. They have proved that the unification problem and the admissibility problem for this modal logic is undecidable. So I propose the following outline for the remaining time that we have. I will introduce some general definition about unification in propositional logic. Then we will solve Boolean unification problem, some simple modal unification problem. We will introduce the notion of unification types, which is a very important notion in unification theory. And then we will see how to solve unification problem in description logics, mainly description logic FL0. And then we will introduce some recent advances in the context of the unification problem in propositional logic, and in particular, the unification problem in dynamic epistemic logics. So if you have no further question, I can continue with this first part about definitions. So we are considering some propositional language. And in this propositional language, what is a substitution? As we have said, it is a function with finite domain which associates to some variable x a formula sigma x. So the substitution, when we apply it to a formula, it simply consists to replace the propositional variable of the formula by the corresponding formula determined by sigma. Substitution being a function, it is possible to compose them, and the composition of the substitution sigma and tau consists to first to apply sigma to a given variable x, and then to apply tau to the sigma x. For example, if sigma consists to replace x by p and x and y by q or y, then when we apply sigma to this implication, we obtained this new implication. Now, we have seen that a unification problem in some propositional logic can have many solutions, can have many unifiers. So it is required to be able to compare substitution in order to see how many solutions a unification problem essentially has. And there is a first binary relationship between substitution. It is this equivalence relation. We will say that in a propositional logic L, sigma and tau, two substitutions are equivalent if, for all variable, when we apply these substitutions to the variable x, then the equivalence between sigma x and tau x belongs to the propositional logic L. And we say that the two substitutions are equivalent in L. For example, these two substitutions, sigma and tau, which consist to replace x either by x equivalent y or x and y or not x and not y, we understand immediately that in classical logic, these two substitutions are equivalent. But there is substitutions which are in a way more general than others or less specific than others. For example, consider this definition. It says that the substitution sigma is less specific than the substitution tau, or we can say more general, if there exists another substitution mu such that when we compose sigma and mu, we obtain a substitution which is equivalent to tau in the logic L. And then here we have a pre-order. It is not a partial order because it is possible for sigma to be less specific than tau, for tau to be less specific than sigma, but not then the two substitutions to be equal. For example, in classical logic, the substitution replacing x by x or y, and this substitution tau, the substitution tau is is more general than tau, because as you can see, we can apply a substitution to this disjunction and obtain exactly this formula. Okay. Now, what is a unifier of a unification problem? Given a formula phi, a substitution sigma is a unifier of phi if sigma phi belongs to the logic we are interested in. We want to know, given a formula phi, if it possesses a unifier. But we also want to determine and to compute a complete set of unifiers for the given formula phi. A set sigma of unifiers of phi is complete. It means that for all unifiers tau of the formula, there exists a unifier sigma of the formula, which is a member of sigma, such that the unifier sigma is more general than the unifier tau. And in fact, not only we interest in complete set of unifiers of a given formula, but in minimal complete set of unifiers. In this respect, there is the notion of basis. A complete set of unifier is a basis if, for any two substitution in that set, if one is more general than the other, then the two substitution are equal. In a way, a basis of complete set of unifiers of a formula is like an anti-chain with respect to this preorder, an anti-chain of unifiers. There is two important properties, and the first property says that a minimal complete set of unifier is a basis. The two notions, to be a minimal complete set and to be a basis, it is the same property. And another classical property is that if a formula is unifiable and if it possesses basis, then all of them have the same cardinality. If a formula a unifiable formula has two bases, then either both of them are singleton, or both of them are finite, or both of them are infinite. And therefore, there is the important questions given a formula. The first question is to ask if it has a unifier. Is the given formula unifiable? And if so, has it a minimal complete set of unifiers? We will see there exists unifiable formula in some propositional logic which has no minimal complete set of unifiers. And the minimality of this set is the crucial point here. And if a unifiable formula has minimal complete set of unifiers, since we know that these minimal complete sets of unifiers are basis for the given formula, and we know that all of them have the same cardinality, then we want to determine if we can effectively compute the minimal complete set of the given formula. These were the traditional definition in the setting of unification theory and adapted to the context of propositional logic. Now, let us consider the context of Boolean unification. Let us consider the standard syntax of classical propositional logic, based, for example, in the false, the negation, and the disjunction. We will consider the abbreviation for the remaining Boolean connective as usual. And notice here that I introduce in the definition of the syntax two kinds of atomic formula, propositional variables and propositional constant or parameters. Remember that when we apply a substitution to a formula, it is only permitted to substitute the propositional formula variable of the given formula. In this context, a unification problem, in fact, elementary unification problem, is given by an arbitrary formula, for example, this formula. And the unification problem it corresponds to means to determine if it exists a substitution sigma such that when we apply sigma to this formula, we obtain a tautology because we are in classical propositional logic. And it is clear that essentially there is only one way, unifier of this unification problem, and it can be represented by the substitution sigma, which replaces x by true or y and y by true. This will mean that this formula is unifiable because sigma is a unifier of it, and it possesses a minimal complete set of unifiers, namely the set consisting of the substitution sigma. And therefore, since this set is a singleton, we will say, it will be precisely defined later, that the given formula, this equivalence, is unitary. If we consider a unification problem with parameters, for example, this conjunction, in this conjunction, we have two propositional variables, x and y, and the propositional constant or the parameters, p and q. There is several unifiers of this formula. For example, the substitution sigma, which replaces x by false, or y by true. It is a unifier of this conjunction for obvious reason in classical propositional logic. But there is also other substitution, for example, this new substitution, which replaces x by p and x and y by q or y. And you can see that if you apply this substitution to the formula, you obtain a tautology. It can be proved that the second substitution, the second unifier of the given formula, this second unifier is a more general unifier of the given formula. It is more general or less specific than any other unifier of this formula. And again, it will prove that this formula is unitary. It possesses a minimal complete set of unifiers, namely the set consisting of this unique substitution, and it is of cardinality one. We have seen the elementary unification problem or parameter-free unification in classical propositional logic. And it is not difficult to show that in this setting, Boolean unification, when the given formula does not contain parameter, is NP-complete because the unifiability of a given formula phi is equivalent to its consistency. We have seen, for example, this formula, and we have given a unifier of it. When we allow parameters to occur in the given formula that we want to unify, things are a little bit more complex, because if a given formula phi based on some finite set of parameters and some finite set of variables, it is unifiable in classical logic, if and only if this quantified Boolean formula, which consists to prefix the given formula phi by this sequence of quantification over the propositional parameters appearing in the P and the propositional variable appearing in the axe X. So this, the unifiability of the given formula is equivalent to the validity of this quantified Boolean formula. For example, this conjunction containing the parameters P and Q, its unifiability is equivalent to the validity of the QBF formula obtained by prefixing this conjunction by the universal quantifications over P and Q, and then the existential quantification over X and Y. And it is typically a pi 2p complete problem to solve the validity of such quantified Boolean formula. We have seen example of unifiable formula in classical propositional logic, and in all these examples, I have said that the unifiable formula possesses a most general unifier. How can we prove that this is the case for each unifiable formula in classical propositional logic? It is a standard result, and it is based on the concept of projective substitution. A substitution is projective. Consider a substitution epsilon. It is projective with respect to a formula phi. Phi is a formula of the classical propositional language. The projectivity of the substitution epsilon means that for each variable x occurring in the formula, we can derive the equivalence between x and epsilon x if we consider the hypothesis phi in classical propositional logic. So this is the definition to be a projective substitution with respect to a formula phi. It is not difficult to show that if we have two projective substitutions with respect to the same formula, then their composition is again projective. And also it is not difficult to prove that if a substitution is projective for a formula phi, then this substitution is more general than any unifier of the formula phi. And so these two lemmas, then it will imply that if a formula possesses a projective unifier, then this formula will be unitary because this projective unifier of the formula will be more general than any other unifier of it. And therefore, it is essential to introduce the concept of projective formula. A formula is projective if it possesses a projective unifier. And then to show that classical propositional logic is unitary, it suffices to prove that every unifiable formula in classical propositional logic is projective. This is not so difficult, and this kind of argument can also be reproduced in the context of other logic, for example, modal logic S5. Suppose that we are given a unifiable formula phi. Consider an arbitrary unifier sigma of phi. Sigma is an arbitrary unifier. It exists because we assume phi is unifiable. And then define a new substitution epsilon as follows. For each variable x occurring in the formula phi, define epsilon x to be this disjunction. This disjunction is defined by means of the formula phi, the variable x, and the substitution sigma applied to x. It is not difficult to show that this substitution is projective for the formula phi. With respect to the formula phi, not only it is a projective substitution with respect to phi, but it is also a unifier of phi. And for this, we will use the lemma, the two lemmas proved asserted in the previous slides. And therefore, Boolean unification, that is to say unification in classical propositional logic, is unitary because every unifiable formula has a most general unifier, namely the projective unifier that is obtained as above. Some remarks about this substitution epsilon that we have defined, it is the so-called Löwenheim substitution. And if the given arbitrary unifier sigma of phi is atom free, that is to say, if sigma x is equal to true or to false for all variable x, then epsilon x can be defined in this way. When sigma x is false, epsilon x is phi and x. And when sigma x is true, epsilon x is phi implies x. And such a Löwenheim form of a substitution have also been used in the context of other logic, for example, modal logic S4.3, modal logic S5, and in the papers of Silvio Ghilardi about intuitionistic logic and transitive modal logic to construct projective unifier of a given formula. Let us see an example. Consider the formula phi, this conjunction that we have seen before. We know that it has a unifier in classical propositional logic. For example, the substitution sigma, which consists to replace x by false and y by true. Obviously, when you apply sigma to phi, we obtain a tautology. Here, p and q are parameters. They cannot be replaced by formulas when we apply a substitution. Now, following the argument developed in the proof of the projectivity that we have seen before, let epsilon be the substitution which associates to variable x and y this disjunction, which is called the Löwenheim disjunction. It is easy to see that epsilon x is in fact equivalent to this conjunction, and epsilon y is equivalent to this implication. And following the result that we have explained in the previous slides, it happens that this substitution epsilon is a projective unifier of phi, and it is more general than any other unifier of the formula phi we are considering. Now, what happens if we consider other propositional logic, for example, modal logics? So we will consider now the problem of unification in some of the most famous modal logics. I will consider the ordinary syntax of modal logics in which the additional connective is this box, the necessity operator of the standard modal logic. And this diamond, the possibility operator of ordinary modal logic, is defined as an abbreviation. It is the dual operator of the box. Remark again that in the definition of the language of ordinary modal logic, I consider two types of atomic formula: propositional variables, which can be substituted, which can be replaced by formulas when we apply substitution, and propositional atoms or parameters, which cannot be replaced by formula. An example of formula or unification problem can be this disjunction, this implication, or this conjunction. So just to introduce very briefly the normal modal logic that we will interest, we will not consider the deep properties of this modal logic, but it is just needed to know that a normal modal logic is a set of formula of the language we have considered, containing all tautologies, containing all instances of that kind, the distributivity axiom, which are closed for modus ponens, for the rule of uniform substitution, and for the rule of generalization. If phi is provable in L, then box phi is provable in L for any logic. The least normal modal logic is modal logic K, in which we assume no specific properties other than these properties for the modal operator of necessity. And we obtain traditionally new normal modal logics by additional axiom, for example, axiom D, if we consider modal logic KD, axiom T, if we consider modal logic KT, axiom 4, if we consider modal logic K4, S4 is the modal logic obtained by adding T and 4 to K, and axiom 5, if we consider modal logic K5, S5 being the modal logic obtained by adding axiom T and 5 to K. So these are classical, this is standard information about modal logic K and its normal extension. There is a first remark that we should say. It is that the problem of elementary unification is trivially decidable, in fact, NP-complete, if in any modal logic which contain the formula diamond true. It is the axiom, additional axiom D that we have mentioned before. And the normal modal logic containing the formula diamond true, it is, for example, modal logic KD, KT, the well-known modal logic S4, S5, S4.3, and it corresponds in the relational semantic to the seriality of the accessibility relation. Why elementary unification is NP-complete, or let us see, decidable, if the modal logic we interest contain this formula? It comes from the fact that any normal modal logic is closed for the rule of uniform substitution. And this implies that if a given formula has a unifier in a given propositional logic, then it has a variable-free unifier. That is to say, it possesses a unifier which does not introduce any variable. But in a modal logic containing the axiom diamond true, every variable-free formula is equivalent either to true or to false. It is a simple property of these modal logics. And therefore, to determine if a given formula phi is unifiable in such modal logic, it suffices to determine if it is possible to replace the variables of this formula either by false or by true, and to check if the resulting variable-free formula is a member of the logic. And this obviously can be done by means of a non-deterministic algorithm working in polynomial time. In the general case, and if we consider also unification and admissibility problem with parameters, the most strong result have been obtained by Vladimir Rybakov, who has proved that the admissibility problem and the unification problem, even in the case when the language contains parameters, propositional constant, for the intuitionistic logic, for the transitive modal logics like S4, Gödel-Lorb logic, K4, he has proved that these problems are decidable. The complexity of the unification and admissibility problem, the complexity of this problem, is not well known. And there is some papers of Emile Girabec which evaluate the complexity, for example, of the admissibility problem in this propositional logic. As mentioned before, it was a question after the result of Vladimir Rybakov to determine if the decidability of the admissibility problem implies the decidability of the modal of the logic itself. And in fact, as mentioned before, Alexander Chagrov has given a rather artificial decidable unimodal logic for which admissibility problem is undecidable. And this has been simplified by Voltaire and Zakariachev, who has determined that every modal logic between K and K4, when the language contains the modality, the universal modality, and these modal logics are decidable, the unification problem and the admissibility problem for this modal logic are undecidable. It is not needed to add the modality, the universal modality, in order to obtain an undecidable admissibility problem for some decidable modal logic. And there is a very simple modal logic for which the consistency problem is NP complete and for which the admissibility problem is undecidable. And it is the product of the modal logic alt one with itself. This is a B modal logic containing two modalities, box one and box two, and the corresponding abbreviation for diamond one and diamond two. And it can be axiomatized by adding to the minimal modal logic of this language, this axiom. The two axioms first are for determinism. This one is for the permutability of box one and box two. And this one is a kind of confluence property. It characterizes the confluence property between the two modalities. It is quite easy to show that the consistency problem in this modal logic is NP-complete, because if we consider the relational semantic of this modal logic, it possesses the small model property, in fact, the polynomial model property. Every formula which is satisfiable, which is consistent in the logic, in this logic, it is satisfiable in a finite model, the size of which is bounded by a polynome. And therefore, it gives the possibility to define a non-deterministic algorithm solving the consistency problem in polynomial time. But by reduction of a domino tiling problem, an undecidable domino tiling problem, it is possible to prove that admissibility problem in this logic is undecidable. So in fact, it exists very simple modal logic, simple by with respect to the complexity of its consistency problem, for which the admissibility problem is undecidable. But the main question in this setting is the computability of unification and admissibility in the least modal logic K. This problem still remains open. It is not known if the unification problem in modal logic K, even without parameters, unification without parameters, elementary unification, it is not known if this problem, and of course, the more general problem of admissibility, is decidable. In fact, not so much is known about the computability of the unification problem in various multimodal logics, hybrid logics, and also description logics. So I would like to ask you if you have some questions so far before starting the new chapter of the tutorial. And I am ready to answer your question if there is. And in the remaining part of the tutorial, we will introduce the notion of unification types. This is the two mainly topics, the unification types in modal logic, modal and description logic. And also we will consider how to solve unification problem in description logic, for example, FL0. So if there is no additional question, I propose to continue and by addressing the definition of unification types. So consider a propositional logic L and a formula phi. Remember that a unifier of this formula is a substitution such that when we apply the substitution to the formula, the resulting formula belongs to the logic. Remember that a set sigma of unifiers of the formula is complete if all unifiers of the formula are can be obtained as a specific instance of a more general unifier in the set sigma. And remember that a complete set of unifiers is a basis if, in a way, it is an anti-chain with respect to this preorder. Now there is the classical result saying that all minimal complete set of unifiers of a given formula phi, if the formula phi possess such minimal complete set, all these minimal complete set of unifiers have the same cardinality. And therefore, the unification type of a formula corresponds in a way to the cardinality of these minimal complete sets of unifiers when they exist. So suppose that the formula phi possess a minimal complete set of unifiers which is of cardinality one. Suppose that that for this formula, which is supposed to be unifiable, it has a minimal complete set of unifiers, that is to say it has a basis of unifier, and this minimal complete set is a singleton. It means that this formula possesses, in fact, a most general unifier. It is a unifier of the formula from which we can obtain, simply by applying other substitution to it, we can obtain all other unifiers of the formula. In that case, the formula phi is of type unitary, or it is type one. For example, in classical propositional logic, we have seen that this formula with parameters p and q is unitary. It is unitary because the substitution sigma, which is defined here, replacing x by p and x and y by q or y, constitute a minimal complete set of unifiers of it. It can happen that a unifiable formula phi possess a minimal complete set of unifiers, for example, here, but this set is not of cardinality one, but it is finite. In that case, we will say that the formula phi is finitary or is of type omega. We mean that such formula, they are unifiable, they possess a minimal complete set of unifiers. This set is finite, but it contains at least two non-comparable substitutions. There is example of finitary formula in intuitionistic propositional logic. For example, the disjunction X or not X, which is not derivable in intuitionistic logic, it can be made derivable if we substitute to X either true or false. And in fact, it can be proved that essentially the substitution sigma and tau, which are described here, constitute a minimal complete set of unifiers of this disjunction. And this can be proved by using the disjunction property of intuitionistic logic. The disjunction property says that if a disjunction phi or psi is derivable in intuitionistic logic, then either phi is derivable or psi is derivable. And the disjunction property of intuitionistic logic can be used to show that these two substitutions constitute a minimal complete set of unifiers of the given formula. And then it shows that the formula is finitary. So this is also a good situation, either when the formula is unitary or the formula is finitary. It can be other situation, and this other situation is called infinitary type. When the formula phi is unifiable, it possesses a minimal complete set of unifiers, but this set is infinite. And knowing the fact that every minimal complete set of unifiers of a given formula have the same cardinality, it will mean that an arbitrary minimal complete set of this formula will also be infinite. In that case, we will say that the type of the formula is infinitary. Unfortunately, there is no known example of an infinitary formula in modal logics and also in intermediate logics. And the worst situation is when the unifiable formula that we consider possess no minimal complete set of unifiers. In this case, we will say that the formula is nullary or it is of type zero. For example, in the very simple modal logic K, this formula that we have already seen, X implies box X, is nullary. It is nullary. The proof of it is not so straightforward. First, we can see that if we replace X by true, obviously we obtained a formula which is in K. True implies box true. But it is also possible to replace X by a little more complex formulas for arbitrary integers K. And these substitutions are also unifier of the formula X implies box X. Unfortunately, it is probable that this unifiable formula does not possess a minimal complete set of unifiers, and therefore it is of type nullary, it is of type zero. Now we have seen the unification type of a unifiable formula. What is the unification type of a logic? The unification type of a logic is determined by the unification type of its unifiable formula. And the best situations is when the logic is either unitary or finitary. We will say that logic L is unitary if every unifiable formula in that logic is unitary. If every unifiable formula in that logic possesses a minimal complete set of unifiers with cardinality one. The situation when the logic is finitary is when every unifiable formula is either unitary or finitary, and there exists at least one finitary unifiable formula. For example, we have seen that in classical propositional logic, thanks to the Löwenheim substitution and to the notion of projective unifiers, unification in classical propositional logic is unitary because every unifiable formula possesses a most general unifier. It has been proved by Silvio Ghilardi that in intuitionistic logic, every unifiable formula is either unitary and finitary. And we have seen the previous slides that there exists a finitary unifiable formula in intuitionistic logic, namely the disjunction X or not X. And for this reason, intuitionistic propositional logic is finitary. The two other situations for a logic is when every unifiable formula is either unitary or finitary or infinitary, and there exists infinitary unifiable formula. In that case, we will say that the logic is infinitary. Unfortunately, there is no known example of an infinitary modal or intermediate logic. And the type nullary is, we said that the logic L is nullary if there exists at least one unifiable formula without a minimal complete set of unifiers. It means there exists at least one nullary unifiable formula for that logic. And for example, in this case, the modal logic K, the simplest, the least normal modal logic, is nullary. The formula X implies box X being unifiable in K, but of unification type nullary. Now let us see some extension of modal logic K and what happens in this case. For example, one of the simplest extensions of K is K4. It possesses K4 is based on the same language, and I will use the same abbreviation for the diamond and an additional abbreviation box plus defined by like this box plus phi is the conjunction with phi and box phi. Modal logic K is an extension of modal logic K. K4 is an extension of K by adding this axiom. This axiom, it corresponds in the relational semantic of modal logic to the property of transitivity of the accessibility relations. It was known since the result obtained by Vladimir Rybakov that unification and also admissibility in modal logic K4 is decidable. Elementary unification and unification with parameters. And it has been proved by Ghilardi that the unification type of K4 is finitary. This means that if we take an arbitrary formula phi, which is unifiable in modal logic K4, then it possesses a minimal complete set of unifiers, and this set is finite. Also, it means that there exists at least one unifiable formula in K4 for which this minimal complete set of unifiers is not only finite, but of cardinality at least two. The proof that K4 unification is finitary I will try to sketch it in order to illustrate the difficulties in determining the unification type of such a simple modal logic as K4. Ghilardi has considered the notion of projectivity in the context of modal logic K4. A formula phi, so we are in the language of propositional modal logic, and we consider the modal logic K4. Ghilardi is considering that a formula phi is projective. It is quite similar to the definition of projectivity that we have developed in the context of classical propositional logic. The formula phi is projective if there exists a substitution sigma, which is a unifier of the formula in K4. That is to say, when we apply sigma to phi, we obtain a formula sigma phi, which belongs to K4. Not only this condition, but the second condition saying that for all variables which occurs in the given formula phi, the equivalence between sigma applied to this variable and this variable is a consequence of box plus phi. Remember that box plus phi is the conjunction of phi and box phi. So this is an adaptation of the concept of projectivity in the context of modal logic K4. A similar notion, the notion of transparency, has been introduced a couple of years before by Vronsky, who defined a formula phi to be transparent if it is quite similar, but you will see a little bit different. A formula phi is transparent. We are still in modal logic K4. If there exists a substitution sigma, which is a unifier of the formula phi, and such that for all unifiers tau of the considered formula, this equivalence belongs to K4. And this equivalence, in a way, it explains why Vronsky has decided to call such substitution transparent substitution. Sigma is transparent because when we apply tau to sigma x, it is equivalent to apply tau to x as soon as tau is a unifier of the formula phi. It is not difficult to show that every in K4, and in many other modal logic, every projective that a formula phi is projective, if a formula phi is projective, then it is transparent. It is an open problem to determine if in all modal logic, every transparent formula is projective. Anyway, with the notion of projectivity, we can sketch the proof of the result saying that modal logic K4 is finitary. So this is the definition of a projective formula in K4 given by Ghilardi. Let us see a very simple example. For example, the formula phi equals x. So just phi is the propositional variable x. Of course, this formula is unifiable. It suffices to replace x by true. And in fact, the substitution sigma x equals true, this substitution is a projective unifier of the given logic, because of course, when we apply to it, when we apply sigma to phi, we obtain true, which is in K4. And also this formula, in order to check the second condition of projectivity, this formula, in the case that we are interested in, is syntactically equal to this implication, which is a formula of K4. So in this very simple example, we see what it means, why the formula X is projective. Now, some other property of projective unifiers. If the substitution sigma satisfy the second condition, which is mentioned here, for all variable x occurring in the formula phi, then it can be proved that for every other formula psi based on the same variable as the formula phi, from x1 to xn, the same implication belongs to K4. So here the difference is that not only we have this implication in K4 for every variable x occurring in the variable in the formula phi, but also for every formula psi constructing from the same variable as phi. And because of the projectivity of the unifier sigma, if we assume that the condition one and two hold, then we can prove that sigma, and because of this condition, we can prove that sigma is a most general unifier of phi. So it is a general rule that projective unifier of a given formula are more most general unifier of that formula. And this, to prove this, is based on the fact that if an arbitrary substitution satisfies the condition two of Ghilardi, then when you compose two substitutions satisfying this condition two, the their composition still satisfy this condition two. So the set of substitutions satisfying the condition two of Ghilardi is closed for the under compositions. Now, in order to sketch the proof that K4 is finitary, we will, here it is still the definition of projective, projective formula, we will consider specific substitutions which are similar to the Löwenheim substitution we have considered for classical propositional logic. So we consider a formula phi based on the variable from x1 to xn. Let us consider an arbitrary subset of the integer from 1 to n. And let us associate to an arbitrary subset of such integers a specific substitution, this defined here. So this substitution, theta indexed by phi and a, associate to an arbitrary variable xi occurring in the given formula, it associates this conjunction or this implication depending on the fact that integer I belongs to A, does not belong to A, or belongs to A. So for each subset A of the n first positive integers, we associate a substitution theta A parameterized by phi. Of course, it can be easily proved that any such substitution, so for all subsets A of the n first positive integers, such substitution theta A satisfy the second condition of the projectivity. And therefore, when we compose any two substitutions, if we consider two subsets of the n first positive integers, if we compose together the two substitutions associated to these subsets, we will obtain a substitution satisfying the second condition of projectivity. For this reason, considering an arbitrary enumeration of the set of all subsets of the n first positive integers, we compose the all substitutions defined like this associated to these subsets. This is done here. And of course, we have 2 to the power n substitutions because it is equal to the cardinality of the power set of the n first, of the set of the n first positive integers. So let us consider the substitution theta phi, which is the composition in some arbitrary order of all substitutions associated to subsets of the n first positive integer like defined here. So we obtain a substitution which can be computed. It is this one. And the following can be proved. Consider still, we are in modal logic K4. Consider the formula phi based on the variable x1 to xn. Consider D to be the modal depth of phi. So it is the maximal number of embedded boxes in the definition of phi. And consider uppercase n to be the number of non-bisimilar equivalent models over the n variable when we only interest in the modal depth D. So I will not say what does it mean for two models to be bisimilar equivalent, but roughly speaking, when two models are two Kripke model, two relational structure defined over the propositional variable x1 to xn, when they are D bisimilar equivalent, it means that they will satisfy the same formula of modal depth less or equal to D. So the number of non-D bisimilar equivalent models over the n variable is finite. It can be computed, and let n be this number. Now consider the substitution theta phi that we have computed at the bottom part of the previous slides and apply this substitution to itself, compose this substitution with itself 2 times n time. It is still a substitution satisfying the second condition of projectivity. And it can be proved that if it is a K4 unifier of the formula phi, if this composition is a K4 unifier of phi, then phi is projective. And reciprocally, if phi is projective, then this substitution that we have obtained in the described way is a K4 unifier of phi. As a corollary, it means that to be a projective formula is a decidable property, because to determine if a given formula phi is projective, it suffices to compute this substitution theta phi, as we have done in the bottom part of the previous slides, to compose with itself this substitution 2 times n times, and to check if the resulting substitution is a K4 unifier of phi. Of course, there is no efficiency. It is quite complex to determine if a given formula is projective, but at least it is a decidable question. And The second important result is the following. If a formula phi has a unifier sigma in K4, then it can be proved that for some formula psi of modal depths less or equal than the modal depths of phi, psi is projective, sigma is a unifier of psi, and this implication belongs to K4. So this lemma says that if a formula phi has a unifier sigma in K4, then there exists a formula psi based on the same variable, of course, as phi, of modal depths bounded by the modal depths of phi, which satisfy these three conditions. We have seen that to be projective is a decidable condition. To be a K4 unifier of a formula is also decidable. It suffices to decide membership in K4. And this third condition is also decidable. Moreover, the number of formula psi, which are potential candidates to satisfy these three conditions, is finite because in modal logic K4, the number of formula based on the same variable as phi and with modal depths at most the modal depths of phi, this number is finite. So it shows that these two lemmas that we have just seen implies that K4 unification is finitary. For all formula phi, if it is unifiable, then it possesses a finite minimal complete set of unifiers. We have seen that the proof that modal logic K4, even if modal logic K4 is a S5. I will consider the same language and still I distinguish between the propositional constant and the propositional variable, namely p and x. By the way, S5 is obtained as the extension of K, modal logic K, by adding these three standard axioms. And it is also interpreted in relational structure, the class of relational structure in which S5 is valid, is the class of all partitions, that is to say, Kripke models in which the accessibility relation is an equivalence relation. In S5, we have a property similar to the property we have shown in the case of classical propositional logic. And it is the following. It is based on the definition of projectivity. Let us define a formula phi to be S5 projective in a way similar we have done for modal logic K4. A formula phi is projective in S5 if it possesses a unifier sigma, which such that this implication is in S5 for all variable x occurring in the formula. So you recognize here a variant adapted to the case of modal logic S5 of the projectivity condition for classical propositional logic and the projectivity condition for the case of modal logic K4. And a unifier sigma of phi satisfying this condition is called projective unifier. As mentioned before, in S5, it is also possible to show that projective unifiers are closed under composition and they are a most general unifier. So, if every unifiable formula in S5 possesses projective unifiers, then it will show that every unifiable formula is of a unification type unitary. And the proof of it is not difficult. It is based on an argument similar to the argument we have used to show that classical propositional logic is unitary. And the property that we want to show is to say that every formula unifiable in S5 is projective in S5. Consider a unification, a unifier sigma of a given modal formula phi. Sigma is an arbitrary unifier of phi. We assume that phi is unifiable in S5. And let us construct a new substitution, the substitution epsilon x, which is this disjunction. It is based on the formula box phi, the variable x, and sigma x. Epsilon x is this disjunction for all variables occurring in x. By means of arguments similar to the one we have developed in the case of classical propositional logic, it is not difficult to show that epsilon is a unifier of phi, and moreover, it is a projective unifier, that is to say, it satisfies the projectivity condition we have introduced just before. And it means that because projective unifiers are most general unifier, it means that S5 unification is unitary. Every unifiable formula in S5 possesses the most general unifier. You recognize here that epsilon is defined in a way similar to the substitution we have introduced, the Löwenheim substitution we have introduced in the case of classical propositional logic. And when the substitution sigma is atom free, when sigma does not contain any atom, it is easily proved that epsilon x is either equal to this conjunction or this implication, depending on whether sigma x is equal to false or to true. And all of this shows that the unification problem in S5 is unitary. We have based the proof that classical propositional logic and S5 are unitary by showing that every unifiable formula is projective. It is true that if every unifiable formula in some propositional logic L has a projective unifier, then unification in L is of type unitary. But it is not equivalent. There exists unitary logic. For example, the extension of S4.2 by Chreborchik axiom, which are unitary, but there exist in this logic unifiable formula which are not projective. What is the situation in modal logic K, the simplest modal logic? Modal logic K, I will consider here only the parameter-free syntax, but all that we will say can be also adapted to the case when parameters are used. And I will use the standard abbreviation for the diamonds and for this box. Box less than n phi is this conjunction for arbitrary non-negative integers. So K is the least normal modal logic. Remind that it is still an open question to determine if unification in K is decidable, even in the parameter-free situation. The first remark is to say that if we want to determine the unification type of K, we can first remark that K unification is not unitary. Consider, for example, the formula box not X or box X. It is unifiable in K because, for example, if you replace X by true, that is to say, applying this substitution, or if you replace X by false, applying this substitution, the resulting formula is a member of modal logic K. And these two substitutions, they constitute a minimal complete set of unifiers of the formula. because of the modal disjunction property. The modal disjunction property holds in K, and it says that if a formula box phi or box psi is in K, then either phi is in K or psi is in K. And this modal disjunction property immediately implies that the substitution sigma true and sigma false described here constitute a minimal complete set of unifiers of the given formula. So this formula is not unitary, it is finitary. And it shows immediately that K, the unification type of K, cannot be unitary. In fact, the unification type of K is nullary. That is to say, it exists a unifiable formula in K such that this formula possesses no minimal complete set of unifiers. And this property has been proved by Emil Gerabek by studying the K unifiers of the formula X implies box X. X implies box X. It is a unifiable formula in modal logic K. For example, consider the substitution sigma true, replacing X by true. It is obviously a unifier of this formula. But also for each non-negative integers n, the substitution sigma n X, replacing X by this conjunction, are also unifiers of the given formula. So here we have infinitely many unifiers of this formula. And it can be proved that this infinite set of unifiers constitute a complete set of unifiers of the considered formula. But is it a minimal complete set of unifiers? For this, it is needed to determine the situation where a unifier sigma of the considered formula is more general than one of these two sets of unifiers. There is a first result saying that if sigma is a unifier of the given formula, then these two conditions are equivalent. And these two conditions, the first one says that sigma is more general than sigma n, and the second says that sigma x implies box n false belongs to K. There is a second property. It relates the arbitrary substitution sigma to the unifier sigma true of the considered formula, and it says that sigma is more general than sigma true if and only if sigma x belongs to K. Put together, with this property, saying that for all formula phi, if the modal depth of phi is n, and if this implication belongs to K, then either this implication belongs to K, or phi itself belongs to K. This is a kind of disjunction property. Put together with the two previous lemma, we can show that the substitutions that we are considering, the infinite set of all substitutions sigma n together with the substitution sigma 2, these substitutions form a complete set of unifiers of our formula. And by means of some additional argument that is quite long, it can be proved that, unfortunately, the formula that we are considering, X implies box X, does not possess a minimal complete set of unifiers. In fact, if we assume that by reasoning by contradiction that X implies box X possess in K a minimal complete set of unifiers, by means of the complete sets that we have constructed here, we will obtain a contradiction, and therefore it will show that the unifiable formula X implies box X is nullary in modal logic K, and therefore K is of unification type nullary. If we interest other propositional logic, and this will finish our chapter about unification in other modal logic, for example, propositional logic, it can be proved by an argument similar to the argument that we have developed in the context of K4, that for every unifiable formula phi in intuitionistic logic, it exists finitely many projective formula psi, which are implying phi intuitionistically, such that every unifier of phi is also a unifier for one of the psi. So the argument is quite similar to the argument we have developed in the context of K4 by means of the projective unifier. And it shows that the unification type of intuitionistic propositional logic is finitary. There exists intermediate logic, for example, the intermediate logic obtained by adding to intuitionistic logic the law of weak excluded middle. This intermediate logic is unitary, and it is in fact the least intermediate logic with unitary unification. So it is the least extension of intuitionistic propositional logic with unitary unification type. It has been considered by Vronsky the extension of the logic of the intermediate logic of Gödel and Demet, which is the login LC obtained by adding to intuitionistic logic this disjunction, which correspond to the relational semantic of intermediate logic to some linearity condition. And it has been proved that an intermediate logic L, so an extension of intuitionistic logic, is projective, has projective unification, if and only if it contains the logic of Gödel and Demet. In parallel, there is also a similar result considering the extension of S4.3. S4.3 is the extension of modal logic S4 by means of this axiom, which also correspond in the relational semantic of modal logic to some linearity condition, similar to the linearity condition characterizing the Kripke model of the logic of Gödel and Demet. And Zick and Wojtylak has proved that the modal logic S4.3, and in fact, all extensions of S4.3, if a formula is unifiable in such extension, then it has a projective unifier. And in fact, the extension of S4 in which unifiable formula have projective unifier, such extension, they must contain S4.3. So the result of Zick and Wojtylak is for modal logic S4 and its extension correspond to the result of Vronsky about the intermediate logic having projective unification. There is a similar result obtained more recently by Kost about the extension of K4. Or K4, as you know, is the extension of K by means of this axiom. And Kost has proved that if we extend K4 by means of this additional axiom, which you recognize here, the specific axiom of modal logic S4.3, this defined the modal logic called K4D1. And Kost has shown that among the extension of K4, among the extension of this modal logic, the logic in which all unifiable formula have projective unifier are exactly the extension of K4D1. Okay, this one, there is no need to interest so much. And then we have just finished now the study of the unification type in modal logics and intermediate logic. Is there some specific questions about these chapters or about the previous slides that we have seen? In a couple of minutes, I want to interest in the unification problem in description logics, and mainly FL0. Okay, if there is no additional question, I propose to continue by the unification problem in description logic. I will mainly interest the description language FL0. Which is one of the most popular description language. It is in fact a syntactic restriction of the multimodal logic K, in which we interest only the true, the Boolean constant true, conjunction, and some necessity connective parametrized by the so-called atomic role R. So in this language of the description language FL0, we have some set of atomic concepts denoted by the letter A, some set of atomic roles denoted by the letter R, and a concept definition is either an atomic concept or the constant true, or a conjunction of two concepts, or the concept prefixed by this universal quantification related to the role R. For example, in FL0, the concept description woman intersection for whole child woman, in which child is an atomic role and woman is an atomic concept, is a concept description. The semantic of FL0 is given by means of relational structure called interpretation. And an interpretation is there is a non-empty set, the domain of the interpretation, and some interpretation function which associate to every atomic concept a subset of the domain, and to every atomic role, a binary relation over the domain. And this interpretation function, as it is classically done, it can be extended to all concept description if we are given an interpretation I, a domain and some interpretation function. This interpretation function can be extended to all concepts of the domain. True is interpreted by the full domain. C intersection D is interpreted by the intersection of the interpretation of C and D. And the universal quantification of the concept C, parameterized by the atomic role R, is interpreted as is interpreted in modal logic, the boxed formula. So in this case, it will be the set of all element D of the domain such that for all element E of the domain which are related to D by means of the interpretation of the role, E belongs to the interpretation of C. So this is the standard semantic definition of the description logic FL0. And the traditional question in the description logic FL0 is to determine, this is a quite old problem, to determine, given two concept descriptions C and D, whether they are equivalent. And it means they are equivalent if for all interpretations I of the language, the interpretation of C and the interpretation of D in I are equal. A related problem is the subsumption problem. The concept D subsume the concept description C. Maybe it is the converse order here. I was wrong. I have written wrongly. If for all interpretation I of the language, the interpretation of C is included in the interpretation of D. It is a standard result that equivalence and subsumption problem in FL0 can be decided in polynomial time. Now, let us interest in the unification problem in FL0. This problem has been put forward by Franz Baader and Palyat Narendran some 20 years ago. And in order to introduce the unification problem in FL0, we have to partition the set of atomic concepts of the language into two separated sets, a set of concept variables that will play the role of propositional variable, and a set of concept parameters that will play the role of propositional constant. So we will denote the variable by this letter, uppercase X and Y, and the parameters by these letters, uppercase A and B. And now the syntax of the description language FL0 with variables and constants can be defined as before, except that now the atomic concept can be either variable or parameters. And we have to extend the concept of interpretation. An interpretation now is a relational structure consisting of a domain together with an interpretation function associated as before a binary relation to every atomic role R, associated a subset of the domain to every atomic concept A, and also associating a subset of the domain to every variable concept X. And of course, the interpretation function can be inductively extended to all concept description, as we have done before. There is no change here. Now, what is a substitution? As it was the case in the context of modal and intermediate logic, a substitution sigma in the case of FL0 with parameters is a mapping associating to every concept variable a concept description in the language of FL0. And as it is done as usual, this substitution sigma can be inductively extended to all concept description as it is described here. So a substitution sigma can be defined completely by the concept description it associates to any concept variables. And as expected, we will say that a substitution sigma unifies in the description language, description logic FL0, unify the concept description CND if the concept obtained by applying sigma to the CND becomes equivalent in all interpretation of FL0. And this substitution sigma will be called a unifier of the concept description CND in description language FL0. And concept description CND are unifiable if they have a unifier. Let us consider the example in which the concept description are the concept CND written here in the last two lines of the slides. In this concept description, we have the variable X and the variable Y, the atomic role R and the atomic role S, and the atomic the constant concept uppercase A. And they are not equivalent. These concepts C and D are not equivalent, but if we apply to them, to C and D, if we apply the substitution sigma defined as above, replacing X by the concept description A and for all S A, and replacing Y by the concept description for all R A, then it becomes easy to check that sigma defined like this is a unifier in FL0 of the concept description C and D. It suffices to use the fact that this conjunction symbol is associative, commutative, idempotent, and that the universal quantification, this modality, distribute over the conjunction. A very simple remark, as it was the case in modal logic and intermediate logic considered before, we can interest in ground substitution. A substitution is ground if it does not contain variable. If substitution sigma is ground, if for all variable x, the concept sigma x, which is replacing x when we apply sigma, the concept sigma x does not contain concept variables. And because of a property which is similar to the rule of uniform substitution, if the concept description C and D are unifiable, then there exists a ground unifier of C and D. This is quite a simple property. And now, how to solve the unification problem in FL0? I will try to sketch the approach introduced by Franz Baader and Palyat Narendran in their the paper that we have that we are studying. First, in order to develop an algorithm for solving the unification problem in FL0, we will consider such equations in which the symbol x1 to xn represent variables, and the symbol of the form S0, S1, Sn, T0, T1, Tn represent sets of words over some alphabet, the alphabet of role names. So let us consider that this S and this T are finite sets of finite words over the alphabet of role names. Here, x1 to xn are variables, and we consider such equation. In such equation, the union will of course correspond to the union of sets, and this symbol, the dot, will correspond to the concatenation of sets of words. If we concatenate two sets of words, we obtain the set of all words which are obtained by the concatenation of two words, one word in the first set concatenated to another word in the second set. For example, we will consider equation of the following form. Singleton R union, singleton RS concatenated with the variable X equal singleton RSS union, singleton R concatenated with the set X. This is the first kind of equation, an example of an equation that we will interest in. And there is just below another example of an equation that we will interest in. What does it mean to solve such equation? For example, the first one, a solution to the first equation, this one, is to determine a solution means to determine a finite set of finite words over the alphabet of whole names, a finite set X of words, such that the union of R together with the result of the concatenation of RS with X is equal, as a finite set of finite words, to the union of RSS together with the result of the concatenation of R with X. Now, consider two concept descriptions C and D, and let us see how we can determine if they can be unified in the description logic FL0. So the concept description C and D contains a concept variable and concept constant. Let x1 to xn be the concept variable they contain, and let a1 to ak be the concept parameters occurring in C and D. We will abbreviate such prefix of universal quantification parameterized by the atomic roles R1 to Rm if it happens to be a prefix occurring in a subconcept of the concept C and D. We will abbreviate this sequence of universal quantification by this one. And we see immediately that R1 Rm is a finite word over the alphabet of the atomic role of the language. And using the distributivity of the universal role with respect to the conjunction, and using the associativity, commutativity, and idempotence property of the conjunction, we can rewrite in an equivalent way each the concept C and D as a conjunction of that kind, in which here the set S and the set T are finite sets of finite words over the alphabet of atomic roles of the language. And here S1, the set S1, Sn, T1, Tn are also such finite sets of finite words. And by using the ordinary property of conjunction and the universal quantification, we can rewrite C and D in this form. And now, once we have rewritten the given concept C and D in this form, it can be proved that the concepts C and D are unifiable in the description language FL0 if and only if for all positive integers I between 1 and k, that is to say, for all the atomic, the concept constant that occur in the concept description C and D from A1 to AK, for all I between 1 and K, some associated equation has a solution. So what is the equation associated to this positive integer I? It is the equation associated to one of the atomic the constant concept occurring in C and D. It is the equation of the type of equation that we have considered before. It is an equation between finite sets of finite words over the alphabet of atomic rule. And it consists of this disjunction for the left part, in which each of the n variable here is play the role of this variable. And here we have S0i, which is the finite set of finite words corresponding to Ai in the description of C. And here we have T0i, which is the finite set of finite words corresponding to Ai in the definition of D. So the unifiability in FL0 of the concept description C and D is equivalent to the solvability of all these equations, separate solvability of all these equations. For example, suppose that C and D are this concept description. So now, using the associativity, commutativity, idempotence, and distributivity of the universal role quantification over conjunction, we can rewrite C and D in the equivalent concept C prime and D prime. For example, C prime is the conjunction of, for all R A1, it corresponds to that part. For all R R A2, it corresponds to that part. And for all RS X1, it corresponds to that part. And D is equivalent to D prime, which is a conjunction of for all RSS A1, it corresponds to that part. For all RSR or RR A2, it corresponds to that part and that part. And for all X1, which corresponds to that part. So the concept description C and D are equivalent respectively to the concept description C prime and D prime that we have written in this form. Here we have two atomic constants, the atomic concept constant A1 and A2. And therefore, according to the result of Baader and Narendran, the unification of C and D, that is to say, the unifiability of C prime and D prime, is equivalent to the fact that this first equation has a solution and this second equation has a solution. This first equation is obtained by considering the concept constant A1. And this second equation is obtained by considering the second concept constant A2. How can we solve such linear equation? It can be solved in deterministic exponential time. This decision problem, in fact, is X time complete. And the main idea of the proof is to represent finite sets of words, because to solve an equation means to determine if the variables occurring in the equation can be replaced by finite sets of finite words over the alphabet of atomic rule in such a way that the equation holds. So finite sets of words can be represented by finite trees. The trees that describe the solution sets in a given linear equation, they form a tree language, because a linear equation may have several trees as a solution. And this tree language can be accepted by a specific automaton of size exponential in the size of the equation, and the emptiness problem for such tree language can be decided in polynomial time. So, of course, all these three parts of the argument are difficult to be proved, but all in all, it implies that the computability of the unification problem in FL0, the unification problem in FL0 between two given concepts can be decided in deterministic exponential time. There is another description language which is also very popular and for which the unification problem have been addressed, mainly by Franz Baader and Barbara Murawska, and it is the description language EL. The syntax of EL is similar to the syntax of FL0, except that here we consider not the universal quantification with respect to some atomic holes, but the existential quantification. So for example, in this setting, example of concept description can be woman and exist job, teacher, intersection researcher, in which woman, teacher, and researcher are atomic concept, and job is an atomic role. As before, an interpretation of the language is mainly determined by a set, the domain of the interpretation, and some interpretation function associated to every concept variable X, a subset of the domain, to every concept constant A, another subset of the domain, and to every atomic role, a binary relation over the domain. And this interpretation function is inductively extended to all concept description. As before, the main difference being the interpretation of the new kind of concept, the existential quantification over C with respect to the role, atomic role R. It corresponds to the interpretation of diamond in Kripke model of modal logic. This interpretation is the set of all elements D of the domain for which there exists an accessible element E of the domain, accessible by means of the interpretation of the R of the atomic role R, such that E belongs to the interpretation of C. So this existential quantification parameterized by role play the role of the diamond of the modal logic. Again, there is some traditional problem in the description language EL, which is the equivalence of concept and the subsumption of concept. For example, the two concepts C and D, they are equivalent if their interpretation in all interpretations are the same. And it is a standard result that the problem of the equivalence of concept in description language EL is decidable in polynomial time. Now, what is the unification problem that has been addressed by Baader and Moravska? It is the same problem. Given two concept descriptions C and D, we have to determine if it exists a substitution sigma, which makes the concept C and D equivalent in all interpretation of the description logic EL. So a substitution in this setting is a mapping associating to every concept variable a concept description. Such mapping can be extended inductively to all concept description as it is written here. And we will say that the substitution sigma unifies the concept description C and D in description language EL if by applying sigma to C and D, we obtained equivalent concept description in EL, and such sigma will be called a unifier of the concept description C and D. For example, a very simple example, the concept description C and D written here, they are not equivalent in EL, but if we replace X by true, for example, or if we replace X by exist R Y, then we obtain two concept description equivalent in description language EL. In fact, the unification problem in the description language EL is much more simple than the description, the unification problem in FL0 because it is NP complete. However, the unification type of it has been determined by Baader and Moravska. And similarly to the unification type of FL0 that we have not mentioned before, it is nullary. It means there exists unification problem in EL, which there exist pairs of concepts C and D, which are unifiable in EL, but for which there is no minimal complete set of unifiers. Strangely, if we eliminate from the language the top concept, remind that the concept, the language of EL is based on the connective true, the Boolean conjunction, and the existential quantification parametrized by a atomic role. If we eliminate from the language the top concept, the true, then the unification problem, instead of to be NP complete, becomes P space complete. This is all that I wanted to say about the unification problem in description logic, there's some historical result in this setting. And now I propose to consider some recent advances and to explain what are the problems and the directions that I consider it should be a benefit to work in order to improve our understanding of the unification problem in modal and description logic. So recently, it has been considered some restriction of the unification problem in the description logics FL0 and EL. What is the restricted unification in the case of FL0, for example? There is two ways to restrict the unification problem in FL0. There is a syntactic way and a semantic way. The syntactic way to restrict the unification problem in FL0 is to say that we restrict the language of FL0 to all concept description of modal depths less or equal than some fixed number. So, for example, if you consider modal depths 2, then restricted unification, syntactic restriction, the syntactic restriction of unification in FL0, we will say that the language is restricted to all concept restriction of modal depths at most equal to 2. It has been proved recently that with such syntactic restriction, unification of concept description in FL0 becomes finitary. Remind, as mentioned before, that unification type of FL0 in its general version is nulla. There is another way to restrict unification in FL0 or EL. It is the semantic description. In the semantic restriction of unification problem, we don't make any restriction on the language. We accept all concept description. It does not matter what is their modal depth, but we will restrict the depth of the interpretation of the model that in which we will interpret the concept description. Remember that a model is a domain, non-empty domain, together with an interpretation of each role as a binary relation over this domain. We can consider that such domains are trees, finite trees, and we will make the semantic restriction by considering only interpretation in which these three have depths at most, for example, 2. And again, the unification type of the unification problem of FL0 with such semantic restriction is finitary. The same kind of restriction have been done with respect to the elementary description language EL. There is a similar consideration that has been done in some extensions of the modal logic K and Alt1. What is these extensions of K and Alt1 that have been considered recently? They consist to add to the modal logic K or Alt1. The modal logic Alt1 corresponds to the modal logic interpreted over a deterministic Kripke frame in which the accessibility relation is deterministic. These extensions consist to add to K and Alt1 a new axiom, box n false, for some arbitrary positive integers n. And from the semantic point of view, K plus box n false is the modal logic corresponding to the class of all trees, all finite trees with depths at most n. And alt 1 plus box n force is the modal logic interpreted over all finite sequence of points of length at most n. Remember that we have seen that unification problem in modal logic K is nullary. It exists a unifiable formula in K which does not possess a minimal complete set of unifiers. The proof of Gerabeck showing that K is nullary can be easily adapted to alt 1, and it has been proved that alt 1 is also nullary. It contains there is a unifiable formula in alt 1 which does not possess a minimal complete set of unifiers. The modal logic for which it has been proved that they are of unification type unitary or finitary, if you remember, are the modal logic S5, which is unitary, and the transitive modal logic like K4, S4, which are and their extensions, which are either unitary or finitary. These modal logics are not transitive when A is greater or equal to 3. Nevertheless, it has been proved that the first K plus box n fold is finitary for elementary unification, and alt 1 plus box n fold is unitary for elementary unification. So this result are the result corresponding to the unification type result obtained in the previous slides with respect to the restricted unification problem in description languages FL0 and EL. There is another family of modal logics for which there is still some open questions. These are the extension of K5. K5 is the modal logic obtained by adding to modal logic K this axiom, which is the so-called axiom 5. And it corresponds in the Kripke semantic to the property of Euclideanity of the accessibility relation. A binary relation is Euclidean if for all point S in the model, if two points T and U are accessible from S by means of the accessibility relation, then these two points can access each other. They can see each other. Axiom 5, this axiom is the characteristic axiom of modal logic S5. The modal logic K5 possesses a very interesting property. All extensions of K5 are finitely axiomatizable, decidable, and the consistency problem for this logic is NP-complete. For example, S5 is NP-complete. The consistency problem, KD45 has a consistency problem which is NP-complete. Let us interest elementary unification in some extension of K5. It is already proved, it is a immediate consequence of the result of cost concerning the extensions of K4 that we have mentioned before, K45 itself, which is obtained from K5 by adding the axiom 4, K45 and all its extensions are unitary. In fact, it is an immediate consequence of the result of cost concerning the projectivity of the extensions of K4. It is known also that K5 and KD5, which is obtained from K5 by adding to it the axiom D, they are also unitary. Remark that neither K5 nor KD5 contain the axiom 4, and therefore the result of cost that we have mentioned before do not apply to these logics. So it has been proved recently that these logics are unitary. Every unifiable formula possesses a most general unifier, but it is still an open question if all extensions of K5 are unitary for elementary unification. It is known that all extensions of K45 are unitary, But the non-transitive extension of K5, it is not known. Although such logic are very well known, their set consistency problem is quite simple. Their unification type is still unclear. Now let us consider some extension of modal logic K containing this axiom, diamond true. For example, KD. KD, we have seen before that if a modal logic contains this axiom, diamond true, then its unification problem for elementary unification is NP-complete because every variable-free substitution is equivalent to a substitution replacing each variable either by true or by false. The unification type of KD for elementary unification is not known. The proof that of Jerabek that K is nullary cannot be applied to KD because in KD, box false is equivalent to false. So the proof of Jerabek heavily relies on the fact that box false and false are non-equivalent in K. In KD, we cannot adapt the proof of Jerabek. And therefore, the unification type of KD for elementary unification is still unknown. But we can adapt the proof of Jerabek in the case of KD when we accept parameters, when we consider the problem of unification with parameters. In this case, we can adapt the proof of Jerabek showing that unification is nullary. So the type of KD for elementary unification is still unknown. And what is unknown also is the computability of the unification problem in KD when we accept parameters. The same can be done in the case of modal logic KT, which is obtained from K by adding this axiom corresponding to the property of reflexivity in the Kripke model. And again, the type of KT for elementary unification is not known, but in the context of unification parameters, it is provable to be nullary because this formula, which is unifiable in KT, does not possess a minimal complete set of unifiers. It is an adaptation of the proof of Jerabek for KT. The same can be done for the modal logic KB, which extends K by means of this axiom corresponding to the property of symmetry in the Kripke models. And KB is nullary for unification with parameters, but considering such formula, which is unifiable but does not possess a minimal complete set of KB unifiers. Yes, this one there is no need to interest. And then I would like to finish this tutorial by considering maybe some introductory comment about a kind of planning problem in the context of dynamic epistemic logic. Here I am considering a multi-agent epistemic logic in which there is some additional modalities corresponding to dynamic update operators corresponding to the concept of public announcement. So in this setting, what is a simple epistemic planning problem? We have two inputs, some epistemic formula phi, written in the language of some multi-epistemic modal logic, multi-S5. And this epistemic formula phi describe an initial state, some initial situation. And we are also given as input an epistemic formula psi in the same language, describing a goal or an expected a state that we expect to reach after some action is executed. And the problem to be solved is to determine if there exists a public announcement, that is to say a formula, chi, in the same language, such that in all states, in all models where the formula phi is true, the public announcement chi can be announced. And after it is publicly announced, then the goal psi holds. How can we formalize such an informal description of this epistemic planning problem. We can formalize it in the language of dynamic epistemic logic. And the formula chi that we are looking for, it should be such that in the language of dynamic epistemic logic, the formula phi imply diamond announcement of chi psi is valid. This formula means the formula chi can be publicly announced, and after it is announced, psi becomes true. And then this can be seen as a unification problem if we consider such formula where x is the unknown variable that we want to instantiate. And this unification problem corresponding to the input output that we have presented above says that find a way to replace the variable x by some formula chi in such a way that the resulting implication is valid in dynamic epistemic logic. So let us consider the case of public announcement logic, and its language is defined as here. We have the Boolean connectives, some propositional parameters, propositional variables, propositional constant here, and epistemic connective parametrized by some agent, agent A. And here, such formula means that agent A knows that phi is true. And there is some dynamic connective parametrized by a formula. And this formula means that if phi happens to be true, then psi holds after phi is announced. The dual connective, this defined here, is interpreted by phi is true, and psi will be true after phi is announced. Okay, we have also the reading of the dual connective to the epistemic modality and the reading of the epistemic modality. This one means agent A knows that phi holds, and this one means that it is compatible with the knowledge of agent A that phi holds. This language is interpreted in Kripke frame, in which each accessibility relation is an equivalence relation, and in model, which as a model is a frame plus evaluation associated to every atomic formula, either a variable or a parameter, a subset of the domain, and the truth condition are the truth condition that we consider ordinarily in a standard way. For example, the epistemic modality is true in the possible world S if all accessible possible worlds T, accessible by means of the equivalence relation associated to agent A, T satisfy phi. The interpretation of the dynamic construct is a little bit different. And in the state S, it is true that this formula holds if when S satisfies the announcement phi, S satisfies the announcement psi in the restriction of the model obtained by eliminating from it all points which does not satisfy phi. This is the standard definition of truth condition in the context of public announcement logic. This dynamic connective satisfies the so-called reduction axiom. It means that for each of these equivalents, they are valid according to the semantic we have developed so far. In order to let us see just one example of a unification problem in the setting of dynamic epistemic logic and to see how it can be solved and maybe to give ideas to if someone wants to interest more general unification problem in the context of dynamic epistemic logic. We have seen that an instance of the problem is given by two formula. The input is a formula phi, epistemic formula phi, and epistemic formula psi, for example, this one. This epistemic formula phi describes some initial state. this epistemic formula here, Ka psi, describes some goal formula. It describes a property that we want to reach in the after some action has been done. And the action we want to do is to do some announcement. For example, we can consider such problem. Does it exist? This problem will consist to determine if there exists a formula replacing X such that in each model, if phi is true, then this formula becomes true. And after it is announced, publicly announced, agent A will know that psi. There is other example of unification problem we want to address, but let us see just one example. In this example, we consider this formula. Consider that psi is a Boolean formula to make things simple. And we want to determine if there exists, so phi and psi are epistemic formula in the multi S5 language. And more precisely, psi is a Boolean formula. There is no epistemic connective. And we want to determine if it is possible to replace the variable x occurring here by some other formula in such a way that the resulting implication is valid in public announcement logic. First, according to the reduction axiom of public announcement logic, the formula P1 is equivalent to the conjunction of P2 and P3. It is coming from the fact that we have the reduction axiom in the public announcement logic as described before. Now, suppose that let us interest the formula P3. P3, if it is valid, then because the epistemic connective Ka is interpreted by an equivalence relation in the Kripke model, the validity of this implication is equivalent to the validity of the implication P3 prime, in which we have moved the connective Ka by its dual here. And then, of course, the validity of P3 prime and the validity of this implication are the same. So, since we want to find a unifier of the formula P1, we want to make this formula valid. In fact, the unification problem we interest in is the unification problem that can be given as the conjunction of this formula with this formula. So, really, the unification problem we want to solve is this one. Now we can see that if there is a solution to this unification problem, it means there is a way to replace X by some formula, and X occurs here and here. If there is a solution to this problem, it means there is a way to replace X by some formula in such a way that the conjunction is valid. But if the conjunction is valid, it means that phi will imply psi is valid. And so a necessary condition for the unifiability of P1 and therefore the unifiability of P4 is the validity of this implication. It is not difficult to prove that it is also a sufficient condition. And when this implication is valid in public announcement logic, in epistemic logic, then a simple unifier of P4 consists to replace X by phi. And then this is a solution to this unification problem. And if we want to interest to the most general unifier of P4, we can apply some the technique that we have applied in the case of classical propositional logic or model logic S5 to compute some kind of a variant of the Löwenheim formula in the context of P4. And this substitution epsilon that is described here can be proved to be a most general unifier of the unification problem that we are considering. So we have seen one example of how to apply the unification technique in the context of dynamic epistemic logic if one wants to solve a very simple epistemic planning problem as described here. Still, it is possible to extend such a unification problem to more complex planning problem. So as a conclusion, I want to say some open questions that still have been not addressed. With respect to the decidability of the unification problem, in the context of modal logic K and KB, elementary unification is not known to be decidable, or parameter-free unification. In the case of KD, KDB, KTB, KT, remember that elementary unification for this logic is NP-complete, but unification with parameters is not known to be decidable. It is also interesting to consider the implicative fragment of modal logics. For example, consider the implicative fragment of modal logic S5, in which the only connective that we consider are implication and the modality of necessity. In fact, it is not exactly true that these are the only connective that can be considered, because if we have implication, we can easily define disjunction. And if we have implication, disjunction, and box, we can easily define the diamond if we interpret formula in the class of all S5 model. Anyway, take some modal logic, for example, S4, S5, consider its implicative fragment based on the implication and the box, and then what happens to the decidability of the unification problem. There is also another fragment of modal logic which is interesting. It is the so-called positive fragment. It has been studied, for example, by Michael Dunn. It consists of considering the box, the diamond, the disjunction, and the conjunction. And then what happens to the computability of the unification problem? And then, of course, the simple epistemic planning problem that we have mentioned before. Now, with respect to the unification types, in the case of elementary unification or parameter-free unification, the unification type of these modal logics, mainly KD, but also this one, is not known. What happens to the fusion of modal logics? What is the unification type of a fusion? If we compare the unification type of the fusion of two modal logic with respect to the unification types of its component, what is the type of unification type of the product of two modal logics? In the application of modal logic to artificial intelligence and computer science, fusions and products are everywhere, and so it is interesting to determine their unification type. What is the unification type of the non-transitive extension of K5, as we have mentioned before? By the way, this extension of K5, they are locally tabular modal logic, like the modal logic K plus box, box false, for example. What does it mean to be locally tabular? A modal logic or intermediate logic is locally tabular if for all finite set of propositional variables, there exist only finitely many non-equivalent pairwise formula based on this finite set of variables. So for example, S5 is locally tabular because if you are given only n propositional variables, you can only construct finitely many non-equivalent pairwise formulas in S5 based on these n variables. And here K5 and many other modal logics, since they are locally tabular, it is expected that their unification type will be simple. Mainly, it is expected that they will be unitary or finitary, but there is no general proof of this one. And again, if we consider the implicative fragment of modal logics or the positive fragment of modal logics, it is also interesting to consider their unification type. For example, the unification type of classical, a very simple, it can change with respect to the unification type of the full language of modal logic. For example, as we know, the unification type of classical propositional logic is unitary in the elementary case and in the case with parameters, but it has been proved recently that the unification type of the implicative fragment of classical propositional logic is finitary in the case of unification with parameters, And therefore, the same questions, the same changes can happen in the case of modal logics for their implicative fragment or their positive fragment. So this is the end of the tutorial. Thank you for your attention.